Hey guys, good morning. Today's topic of discussion is 802.11 security. So the contents are like this. First of all, we will look into introduction to Wi-Fi security, types of security and their overview, station IP connection with no security, 802.11i overview, 802.11i protocol operation, then four way handshake for both the WPA connection and WPA2 connection as well. Finally, we will have a look into the comparison of WPA versus WPA2. So let's start with the introduction to Wi-Fi security. Wi-Fi protected access, in short WPA, Wi-Fi protected access to WPA2, and the final one is Wi-Fi protected access 3, that is WPA3, are three security protocols and security certification programs which was developed by the Wi-Fi Alliance to secure wireless computer networks. The Alliance defined this in response to the serious weakness which researchers had found in the previous system, that is WEP, Wired Equivalent Privacy. So, in order to overcome this weakness in web, they came up with a protocol called WPA, which became available in the year 2003. The Wi-Fi Alliance intended it as an intermediate measure in anticipation of the availability of the more secure and complex WPA, which became available in the year 2004. In January 2018, Wi-Fi Alliance announced the release of WPA3 with several security improvements over WPA2. Coming to types of security, this first of all we will look into the WPA. The Wi-Fi Alliance intended WPA is an intermediate measure to take the place of web. WPA could be implemented through firmware updates on wireless network interface cards. TKIP, that is Temporal Key Integrity Protocol, was adopted for WPA. Earlier, web was used 64-bit or 128-bit encryption key that must be manually entered on wireless access points and devices that does not change at all. But this TKIP employs a per packet key, meaning that it dynamically generates a new 128-bit key for each of the packet and thus prevents the type of attacks that compromised web. I hope it clear to you. WPA also includes MIC, that is Message Integrity Check, which is designed to prevent an attacker from altering and resending data packets. What happens in between, some hacker will come and they will capture the packets and they will alter it and resend it so that the actual recipient will get confused. So they came up with a technology called MIG, which is designed to prevent an attacker from altering and resending the data packets. This replaces the CRC, cyclic redundancy check, that was used by the web standard. CRC's main flaw was that it did not provide a sufficiently strong data integrity guarantee for the packets it handled. WPA used MIC algorithm called TKeep to verify the integrity of packets. TKeep is much stronger than CRC, but not as strong as the algorithm used in WPA2. Now we will look into WPA2 overview. WPA2 was replaced WPA, which implements the mandatory elements of IEEE 802.11i standard. It includes basically the mandatory support, which is CCNP, that is an AES based encryption mode. So going further, we will look in detail of this. Let's go with the overview. From March 13, 2006, WPA2 certification is mandatory for all the new devices to bear with the Wi-Fi trend. WPA3. In January 2018, the Wi-Fi Alliance announced WPA3 as a replacement of WPA2. This new standard uses 128-bit encryption in WPA3 as well, that is in personal mode, 192-bit in the WPA3 enterprise mode, and another technique called forward secrecy. The WPA3 standard also replaces the pre-shared key exchange with simultaneous authentication of equals, resulting in a more secure initial key exchange in person. The Wi-Fi Alliance also claims that this WPA3 will mitigate security issues posed by weak passwords and which can simplify the process of setting up devices with no display interface. So first of all, we will look into this station IP connection establishment with no security, that is open connection. So the left side I marked it as station and right side as access point. So first of all, access point is beaconing. When station want to get connected with the AP, first of all it has to send the probe request, which is a probe customer. In response, probe response will come, then acknowledge it. Then beacon is happening. Authentication request, authentication response. Here you can see this is open authentication. There is another type of authentication as well, that is called shared authentication, but here it's not applicable. That's the reason here specifically written as open system. Okay. After authentication request and response, association request and association response happens, and the connection establishment happens. So connection establishment is happening in infrastructure mode with no security, that is open network involves the following basic steps. First step is the scan method. In case of active scan, the station would send out a probe request and receive a probe response from the AP. Similarly, in the case of passive scan, the station would find the AP by listening to the beacon. Then authentication and association will happen. Coming to adrenal 2.11 overweight. IEEE adrenal 2.11i, which came into picture in the year June 2004, implemented as WPA2, that is Wi-Fi Protected Access 2. This standard specifies security mechanisms for wireless networks, which supersedes previously security specification WEP, which was shown to have security vulnerabilities. WPA had previously been introduced by the Wi-Fi Alliance as an intermediate solution to web securities. WPA implemented a subset of 802.11i, whereas Wi-Fi Alliance implemented the full 802.11i as WPA2, also called RSN, Robust Security Network. 802.11i makes use of AES, Advanced Encryption Standard, which is nothing but the block cipher, whereas WEP and WPA use the RC4 stream cipher. Coming to protocol operation, 802.11i enhances by providing a RSN, Robust Security Network, with two new type of protocols. First one is four-way handshake and the second one is group key handshake. The standard also provides two RSNA, Robust Security Network Associations, Data Confidentiality and Integrity Protocols, TKIP and CCNA. Implementation of CCMP being mandatory, since the confidentiality and integrity mechanisms of TKIP are not as robust as those of CCMP. The initial authentication process is carried out by either using PSK, that is pre-shared key, or following an EAP exchange through 802.1x, that is known as EA port, so which is required the presence of authentication server. We will look what is PSK, how it's coming into picture, but in this session we are not going to discuss about 802.1x. We will talk about this in a later session. Okay. The process ensures that the client station, that is station, is authenticated with the access point. After the PSK or 802.1x authentication, a shared secret key generated, which is called as PMK, Pairwise Master Key. So the pairwise master key, that is PMK, is derived from a password called PSK that is put through PBKDF2SHA1, that is called password based key derivation function version 2 as the cryptographic hash function. I think you guys got a little confused here. What I'm trying to say, suppose you are having an AP. Let's say it's configuring WPA2 security. For the time being, let's consider the password is 1234567 8 digit password. Okay. So whenever a station wants to connect with the AP, it has to enter the password as 128. Okay. So this password 128 is called PSK, pre-shared key. A key which is shared before, pre-shared key. I hope it's clear to you. Then PMK will come into picture. So from PSK, how PMK is derived? PSK has to go through a function that is called PBKDF2SHA1, which is called password based key derivation function. Okay. Basically, this function is used for cryptographic hash function. So in this way, from PSK, PMK is going to generate. The purpose of generating PMK is, which will be working as an input to the four-way handshake. So here we are going to look what is four-way handshake for WPA connection. So beacon and probe response frames from AP includes WPA-IE, AP WPA capabilities. So suppose the AP is computing WPA. In the beacon, how we will come to know that AP is computing WPA security? By looking into the beacon, we will see that there is a specific IE called WPA-IE. By that, we will come to know that AP is computing WPA security. Okay? So AP is going to advertise itself in beacon and probe response as well. So here probe request, probe response is happening. Okay. Then in the probe response, beacon with the WPA-IE station is now aware that AP is enabled with the WPA capabilities. Then the association request from station includes the WPA-IE. Then the station is going to send the authentication request. Authentication response will come in from the AP. So this is again the open system authentication, you can see it out here. Okay. This authentication request from the station contains the WPA-IE. Then the four-way handshake will come into picture. A four-way handshake is used to establish another key called the PTK, pairwise transient key, PTK in short. So after this authentication process, association request will go from station to AP, then the acknowledgement, then AP will check the station WP capabilities. Depending upon that, association response will be sent from the AP to station and an acknowledgement will come. So here the four-way handshake will come into picture. So this PTK is generated by concatenating the following attributes using a pseudo random function that is called PRF. So the inputs to create PTK are 5. First of all, PMK, which we found from PSK. Okay. Then the announce, which is sent by AP. In short, we called AP announce. In short, we called it as announce. The second one is called S-nounce, that is station nouns. The fourth one is called AP MAC address. And the last one is called station MAC address. So basically, these are the 5 inputs to create PTK. So here you can see the first EPOL message, that is called M1, was sent by AP with announce and a replay counter. Okay, then the acknowledgement is sent from station to AP. Here stations responsibility is to derive the PTK from these inputs. Then in message M2, epole 2, it will send from the station to AP. So in M2 message, what will be sent? S nouns and a mic with replay counter 1. See, in the M1, AP sent A nouns with replay counter 1. In M2, station set S nouns with mic and replay counter 1. I will let you know what is replay counter, what is its significance also. So basically, after this M2 message got by AP, it has to compare A. Then AP has to generate it has to derive its own PTK, and after that it will verify with the MIG sent by the station. Okay, if both are equal, then it has to go through to the M3 packet. In the M3 packet, what it's going to tell to the station, saying that you can install the PTK, then it will set the install bit equal to 1 with another MIG, and here the replay counter will change to 2. Then an acknowledgement will come into picture. Here it will install the PTK, that is pairwise key, and the final message will send that in the M4, saying that MIG and replay counter 2, and this will acknowledge you. Okay, so here then it will install the pairwise key. After that, it will send group keys encrypt frames with the PTK. It means that at this stage, it's going to generate the GTK. Here, epoch key group M1 announce initialization vector MIG GTK with replay counter 3. So what I mean to say is, here PTK got generated, here it will generate GTK, that is group temporal key, that is a group key, and after that, in this message, it's going to tell the station that you can install group key. And to that message, the station will acknowledge to the AP, saying that I installed and you also please install. So install group key. After that connection has happened, and the data transfer will be encrypted. Okay, so I was saying replay counter. Here if you will see, for message M1 and M2, replay counter is 1. For this M3 and M4, replay counter is 2. Again, for these two messages, replay counter is 3. It means that for a couple of messages, for two messages, to and fro messages, it is counting the replay counter as 1. Then for another two messages, 2. Then for another two messages, 3. Okay. Coming to PTK, in the earlier slide, we look what are the inputs. Inputs are 5 things, right? So then the PTK going to generate. So PTK, here this is PTK I'm seeing. So PTK consists of this following keys. First one is epoll KCK, that is of size 16 bytes. Then epoll KEK, which is again of size 16 bytes. Third one is TK, which is again 16 bytes. And the fourth one is TKMIG, which is again 16 bytes. It means that PTK, which is going to generate from both the station side and the AP side, is of size 64 bytes. We have to remember this. So basically, this KCK is used for integrity protection of the epoll messages. WPA does not use KEK. Then this group key consists of group temporal key, which is of 16 bytes, and group make 16 bytes. So if you look at here, PTK is of size 64 bytes, whereas group key, that is GTK, is of size 32 bytes. Okay, this is all about WPA connection. Then 4-way handshake. This is a overall 4-way handshake overview. Okay, the 4-way handshake is basically designed so that the AP, which is called authenticator, and the wireless client, which is called as supplicant, can independently prove to each other that they know the PSK or PMK. So this is the M1 packet comes from AP to station. So a 4-way handshake is used to establish another key called PTK, this one, pairwise transient key. The PTK is generated by concatenating the following attributes using the PRF, which is called pseudo random function, which we already discussed in the earlier slide for WPA. This is for WPA 2 connection we are discussing. Again, the inputs are same: PMK, Announce, Snounce, AP MAC address, and Station MAC address. Don't get confused. Announce is nothing but a random number which is generated by AP. Similarly, Snounce is a number which is generated by Station. So this is nothing but the overall picture of 4-way handshake. M1 message, Announce. M2 message, Snounce plus MIC. Here station is going to generate PTK, then here AP will construct the PTK, then here if it will require, AP is going to generate GTK, then GTK plus MIC, then the final is acknowledgement. Now we will look one by one packets. So M1, which is sent by AP. Okay, AP sends the announce value to the station together with a key called replay counter, which is a number that is used to match each pair of message sent and discard replayed messages. If the message is repeated, it has to discard. The station now has all the attributes to construct the PTK, because as we now know that to generate PTK, basically 5 inputs are required. So now station is having all the inputs. It will generate PTK. Then station will send its own nouns value snounce to the AP together with the message integrity code MIC, and the key replay counter, which will be the same as message one, okay, to allow AP to match the right message one. Similarly, after getting M2, the AP verifies message 2 by checking the MIC, RSN, announce, and key replay counter field. And if all the things are valid, then it sends the GTK with another MIC. Finally, the station verifies the message 3 by checking the MIC and the key replay counter field, and if valid, it sends confirmation to the AP. So this is the message 1 for WPA2 connection 4-way handshake. This is if PSK, pre-shared key, this 4-way handshake starts immediately after the open system authentication and association state finish. Here you can see, first of all, authentication request and response is happening. Then association request and response is happening. Then message 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay, These all are message exchanges. If it is a WPA 2 connection with 802.1x, that is EA port, okay, then 4-way handshake starts with EAP authentication first. Here authentication request, authentication response, then this is all for EAP method. Request identity, response, response identity. We will look into this afterwards. But what I mean to say is, in the earlier case, in the PSK, after authentication process, PMK is going to generate. Similarly, here after the 802.1x authentication, PMK is going to generate, then the 4-way handshake will come into picture. Let's go one by one message. This is the message 1. This message 1 will come from AP to the supplicant, that is station. So with this information, supplicant have all the necessary input to generate the PTK using the pseudo random function. So here you can see, this is the EPOL RSN key, robust security network, and this came from AP to station, and here AP is sending its announce value. Coming to message 2, this will send by supplicant after generating the PTK. The supplicant sends this EPOL 2 key frame containing SNOUNCE to the authenticator. Now authenticator has all the inputs to create PTK. So here you can see, this is again a RSN key, and station is sending its announce value with MIC. Okay, so supplicant also send an RSNI capabilities to authenticate the MIC. Authenticator derive the PTK and the validate the MIC as well. After getting the message 2, AP has to do couple of things. First of all, if necessary, authenticator will derive GTK. What I mean to say, first of all, when the message 2 was received by access point, that is authenticator, it will generate its own PTK and MIC. Then it has to compare both the MIC from the station and its own MIC. If at all both are equal, then only it will generate the GTK, I mean the authenticator. Okay? Otherwise, it will not generate the GTK. Authenticator sends this EPOL keyframe containing announce, RSNI, and MIC. This is RSNI. In the third packet, that is M3, it has to instruct to the station sync that you can install the PTK. So that's the reason this installation bit set to 1 with nouns values, MIC. GTK will be delivered, which is encrypted with the PTK to the supplicant. So message to supplicant to install the temporal keys. These are the temporal keys, PTK and GTK. And final message is M4. Supplicant sends final EPOL keyframe to the authenticator to confirm temporal keys have been installed. From this point onwards, data frame MSDU will be encrypted using PTK or GTK, which depending upon the unicast or multicast protocol. Here I would like to tell you a couple of things. See, after getting M2 message, API has to generate its own PTK. So normally in the interview, they comes up with a twist question, like they will ask, suppose you are connecting from station to API, which API is in WPA2 security, and station entered a wrong password. In the sniffer, up to which message you will look? This is a very typical question normally they are going to ask you in the interview. So what happens? Logically, what will happen? M1 will be sent by API to the station. Then station is going to generate its own PTK. Then it will send M2 message where the S-nouns and MIC will come into picture. In the third step, when M2 message got received by API, it has to generate its own PTK and MIC. Then the comparison will take place. If the MIC sent by station will equal to the MIC of its own, then only it's going to generate the GTK. Am I right? So we know that station entered a wrong password. So whatever PTK is generated and the MIC value came, obviously it's going to differ with the MIC value which is generated by the API. Am I right? That's the reason here the API, I mean the authenticator, it's not going to send the M3 message. Hence you can see up to the M2 message, M1 and M2. You are not going to see the M3 message. The connection will not happen. This is a very logical question, right? Second thing, what is the use of PTK and what is the use of GTK? Why we are creating two types of messages? So PTK is nothing but we are using to encrypt the unicast packets. That is the only purpose of PTK. When some multicast or broadcast packets are there, we have to use GTK. That's the reason we are creating two types of packets, two types of keys, PTK and GTK. Finally, WPA versus WPA2 comparison. So if you look into the encryption type, WPA use RC4 stream cipher, whereas WPA2 use AES block cipher. Message integrity, WPA use MIC, whereas WPA2 use transient key, TK. Group key wise, if you look, WPA use only TK, whereas WPA2 use TKIP or CCNP. Sorry, here spelling mistake happened. TKIP or CCNP, TKIP. Information element, WPA-IE use by WPA, WPA2-IE use by RSNI. WPA released in the year 2003, which replaced WEP, whereas WPA2 came into picture in the year 2004, which replaced both web and WPA. One more thing I forgot to tell you here. A typical question normally in interview they ask in security part, that how as a test engineer, yeah, as a developer, how you will come to know that your access point is configured either in WPA or WPA2 by looking at the sniffer. It's very simple. If you go to the beacon, if your API is configured in WPA, then you are going to see the WPAIE. Whereas for WPA2, you are going to see the RSNIE. Hope I gave some idea about 802.11i, 802.11 security protocols, everything. Hope you can understand both the things. So thank you so much for watching this video. If you would like to ask any questions, comments, you're always welcome. Thank you guys. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for your time.